Hi, thank you for joining us. If you're just joining us, we're talking about pre-existing health conditions and managing it amidst the COVID-19. Now, remember, you can join the conversation, Twitter us at PlusTV Africa or at Wayshow Africa 1 with the hashtag Ways, or you send us SMS or WhatsApp to 081-803-8463. Thank you, Dr. Tosin, for staying with us.
No problem.
Now, you heard everything Dr. Yemisi said. Would you like to add a few things before we come back to health conditions?
I think everything that Dr. Yemisi said really applies, and I will probably be more specific on heart conditions, but everything she said really applies to heart conditions as well.
Okay.
So the importance of keeping an eye on your condition, with whatever it is, heart condition, blood pressure, diabetes, at this time more frequently, being in touch with your doctor while trying to respect social distancing. But something that we're going to come to talk about is also recognizing those triggers or symptoms that should alarm us and tell that this person can no longer stay at home and needs to come to hospital. But those are things that we will talk about as well.
Okay. So, as a cardiologist that deals with hearts, are there measures put in place to actually combat COVID-19?
So a lot of the measures that we've actually put in place, a lot of the things that we talked about for diabetes with Dr. Yemisi. Mm-hmm. So as a hospital, we have actually told most of our regular patients for routine appointments not to come to the hospital,
okay,
and to stay at home and to try and manage their conditions over the phone or through telemedicine platforms, so that we can check their blood pressures and just advise them appropriately whether they need to increase or decrease their medications as needs be. And those are really the measures we're putting. But it's also to give them some education and reassurance. So a lot of our cardiac patients, for example, are always breathless. And as you know, even people who are young and healthy these days are very paranoid. The moment they feel anything, a little tickle in the throat, a little bit breathless when they climb the stairs, they're like, oh, is something happening to me? And it's to try and reassure them that these patients who are already breathless, to reassure them that as long as your breathlessness does not change, mm-hmm, as long as you haven't developed any features suggestive of COVID-19 as per the World Health Organization guidelines, that they can be relaxed and continue to manage themselves at home. We also try and educate them that if there is a change in their symptoms, they develop a fever, they get a new cough or a different cough to what they may have had previously, or develop breathlessness, then those patients, we may, after speaking to them on the phone, decide that maybe we need to bring them into the hospital and assess them either for an exacerbation of their existing condition, or if they have developed COVID-19, for example, in which case, if we're suspicious, we will have to protect our staff with the appropriate personal protective equipment and assess the patients appropriately as per NCDC guidelines.
Okay, so Dr. Tosin, now, I read all you people's statistics, Dr. MBC's and yours is very scary. Because one person dies every 37 seconds in the US for cardiovascular disease.
Correct.
It is crazy. Mm. When I saw those figures, in 37 seconds, one person is dying.
That's
and, you know,
right.
what struck me the most is that the death was accounted at 23%, 23.5% of this death is related to the black race.
Yes.
You know, so I'm now wondering, what is this, you know, because something about ischemic heart disease, 14% of death. So what is this? Why is this figure high, especially amongst the black race?
That's a very good question. So cardiovascular disease is the biggest cause of death worldwide.
Whoa.
It's still the biggest cause of death worldwide. And I think you make a very important point that in the midst of this COVID-19 pandemic, which of course is very important and is something we are all paying a lot of attention to, especially while we're talking about it on this show, we cannot forget that a higher cause of mortality remains cardiovascular disease, especially ischemic heart disease, which you talked about, which, as you mentioned, in the US, there's one person every 36 seconds dying from this. So as medical health professionals, especially those of us as cardiologists, we face a dilemma. Because we will get phone calls from patients who may be having ischemic heart disease. Yeah. And sometimes we have a problem because these patients don't always have chest pain, which is one of the symptoms of ischemic heart disease, but they're breathless. And so if you have a breathless patient who calls you, they're more likely to be elderly, maybe above the age of 65 or 70. They can be more likely to be male. They're going to have the other risk factors for COVID-19, which is maybe they have diabetes, maybe they're obese. And then these are the patients who call us, and we now have a decision to make. Is this just a normal patient presenting with ischemic heart disease, or is this a patient presenting with COVID-19? And this is a huge problem for health facilities worldwide in trying to make a difference between these patients. In places like Italy, Spain, and the US, pretty much everybody that turns up at your door now has to be treated as though they have COVID-19. Now in Nigeria, I think we're pretty much heading in the same direction. The last 3 days, we've noticed quite a significant increase in the numbers, the daily numbers that have been reported. So I think it's been 30, 35, and I think yesterday was about 53.
Yeah.
So this, the rate of increase is of concern. We're hoping that we will be able to flatten the curve, as we've all learned about these days. But if it continues to increase, we're going to face more and more challenges in trying to decide between our patients who have the pre-existing conditions and those who are presenting with COVID-19.
How healthy is the average Nigerian citizen, generally?
Unfortunately, not very healthy, especially when we're talking about our older age group. So there are statistics out there that report that about 1 in 2 adult Nigerians has hypertension.
Oh my God.
1 in 2. And I remember when I first moved back from the UK, in the UK, it was kind of unusual for me to see a 30-year-old or someone between the ages of 30 and 40 having high blood pressure. So when I first came to Nigeria and I see these patients, I would be thinking, well, something strange must be
going
on. And I have to do some special tests to try and work out what's going on. And then after a while, I kind of worked out that actually there's just so much hypertension in the country.
Lifestyle.
It's all lifestyle. So and it's all due to all of the things that we've spent a lot of time talking about.
Mm-hmm.
People are overweight. People aren't exercising. People's diet are not very good. Our lifestyle, particularly in Lagos, does not lend itself generally to a healthy lifestyle.
Precisely.
People are waking up at 4 o'clock in the morning. They don't have time to prepare anything, fresh food or vegetables. They eat whatever they can find on the street, which is generally not healthy, soaked in oil or soaked in lots of sugar. Getting home late at night and going to
11 p.m.
These are not lifestyles that are conducive to having a healthy blood
lifestyle.
Pressure, healthy blood sugars, and all the rest of it. So it is not a surprise that we are not a healthy country. We do not have a healthy population, particularly our older population, in terms of the risk factors that we are concerned about. And we have a lot of ischemic heart disease in Nigeria.
Okay, doctor. I mean, now my heart is palpitating. Okay, so what do we do? So when it comes to knowing the signs. Now, because I was saying to you before we came on the show, I said it was so easy to go on Google and Google the figures and they will tell you that COVID-19, yes, okay, but 23% had links with diabetes, 30% had links with pre-existing, heart disease. But in Nigeria, the NCDC would just say, oh, someone has died of COVID-19 without the medical history of that person. So we're not able to document those things. Where do we start to draw the line? Because I think we're very, very, when it comes to our health, we are very, you know, we tend to go spiritual and there's a very shroudy nature. We don't tell people that, oh, I'm asthmatic or I have diabetes or something. We try to just cover it up. And we are seeing that those things are not helping us because people are actually, you know, dying. And
as a result
instead of the proper diagnosis, the postmortem to come out to say, you know what, this is what and what and what that eventually led to the death. Nobody's saying that. So now a lot of people are in panic. You know, people that are not supposed to be panicking, they are panicked because, of course, we're not documenting those details well. So what would you say to that?
I think one of the things that we are seeing in Nigeria in terms of our statistics, and I think you make a point in that we're not getting as much detail in our statistics as you're getting outside of Nigeria. But what we are seeing in our statistics actually mirrors very nicely what is happening all over the world, which is largely an older group of people being sick, an older group of people having complications, getting critically ill, and unfortunately not making it through this illness, as has been on the news all day today,
with
the chief of staff who recently passed on. We are seeing that he was an older gentleman with pre-existing health conditions, and he's the one, unfortunately, met his demise due to COVID-19. And I think what we should do is continue to pass the message out to the public that these are the people who will have the problem. You had to give the list of statistics earlier of the age groups and the conditions that have them. The people who fit into those age groups should stay indoors and should manage themselves as best as they can. They should consult with their physicians from home as much as possible and try not to expose themselves. For the younger population, I think this is a very important point. They may feel invincible, and they may be. You may see some reports abroad that, you know, there have been 26-year-olds who've passed away, 40-year-olds who've passed away. It's important to state that under normal circumstances, even with the seasonal flu, young people do sometimes pass away from them. But in spite of that, it is not for our younger population to feel that they're invincible and feel that then the lockdown doesn't apply to them. Because as you mentioned in the beginning, there are asymptomatic carriers. And the purpose of the lockdown, why everybody should stay at home as much as possible, is to prevent the spread of the virus to people who are not going to be able to deal with the complications or who are more likely to have a poor outcome if they get COVID-19. So I think it's important to state that for the younger population, that they also have a role to play, that even if they're very unlikely to get a severe illness, they have a role to play in making sure that their older ones, whether they're your parents, your uncles, your neighbors, your colleagues, that they don't get a more severe cause of the illness due to them.
Okay, so Karim has sent a question on WhatsApp. It says, at this time, can we differentiate between common regular cold and COVID? With changing weather conditions, we always experience changes in our body, such as sore throat and cough, and with the weather change, I think you mentioned that earlier.
Absolutely.
So
right.
How...
You tell it the is, difference.
It is very difficult. It is very difficult. In an ideal world, what we should have are enough testing kits to test anyone who comes forward.
Since it's not an ideal world.
Absolutely.
Right now.
In an ideal, so anyone, what I would suggest to anybody who has any symptoms at this moment in time is, if your symptoms are not severe, whether it's the common cold, whether it's just the flu, whether it's COVID-19, stay at home.
Okay.
Do not leave the house. Because the most important thing in our situation is to maintain social distancing and to prevent spread of the possible COVID-19 that you may have to other people. Because if it's a cold, it will get better by itself. You don't need to see a doctor. If it's the flu, it will get better by itself. You don't need to see a doctor. Even if it's COVID-19, 80 to 85% of people, it will get better by itself without you having to see a doctor or have anything done. That's
really?
A very important point.
So why do they
point.
Go to the isolation centers?
Well, the point of the isolation centers is to stop it spreading to other people. It's not so that they are going to receive any specific medical treatment unless they are particularly symptomatic. The people that need to go to hospital who have COVID-19 are those who are having difficulty in breathing, who are experiencing shortness of breath. Those are the people that need to go to hospital and say, maybe I'm someone who needs supplemental oxygen and needs to be in a hospital environment to make sure I don't become critical from COVID-19. Now, I'd just like to make one last point.
Okay.
Very important for our cardiac patients who are at home. There are still going to be people who have heart attacks during COVID-19. There are still people who are going to have asthma attacks during COVID-19. If you have such symptoms where you have difficulty in breathing, you have bad chest pain, or you're having very bad palpitations that you feel are very serious, you should still go to the hospital and be assessed to see what is wrong with you and receive the proper treatment. It would be a shame for people who have treatable conditions not to go to hospital and die at home because they're worried about leaving the house.
That was the question I was going to ask.
Oh, really?
How do we manage somebody who has a cardiovascular problem? So let me now digress from that. Okay, the pandemic has already begun. So what has been most challenging for you during this period? Having to treat people with cardiovascular problems.
I think it's really the biggest challenge has been the anxiety. The anxiety in our patients, the anxiety in our staff, the anxiety in the public at large, where people are so concerned that they may catch it from somebody else, or when they have even mild symptoms, they're worried that they may have it, even if they don't have the features that suggests that they have COVID-19. That really has been the major challenge, and I have spent a lot of time over the phone with a lot of patients just reassuring them. They say, oh, I had a slight headache yesterday. Do I have COVID-19?
Okay, somebody's even asking you that
there
question.
You go.
He said, hi, my name is Rose. I am 22. Mm. I want to know if having sharp pains in my heart in my heart area is worrisome. Am I not too young for that? That's from Rose.
So it is very unlikely that a 22-year-old with sharp chest pain has any significant cardiac problem, or certainly not a feature of COVID-19. I would reassure Rose that it is unlikely that she has a problem and that she should just take some simple medication like paracetamol or whatever and you will get better. If, however, after a few days it doesn't get better or seems to get worse, then she should absolutely present to a hospital and get herself assessed.
Okay, so when is the right time for one to start to check for heart disease? Because your I'm still in shock of your analysis, you know, that you said one in every two adults has hypertension.
Yes.
That's scary.
It is.
So when is the appropriate time to start to check, you know, your heart health condition?
Well, it's never, the correct answer really is that it's never too early to start to pay attention to your health and to start to have regular checkups. What I do tend to emphasize to my patients are that once you hit the age of 40, then you really have to start paying attention to your health. What I tell my male patients particularly, okay, once you hit the age of 40, all the lifestyle, playboy lifestyle is over. Married or unmarried, you now have to just start behaving yourself. You need to start becoming a boring old person to an extent. You need to start eating your fruit and vegetables properly. You need to have a very good diet, avoid fatty food, oily foods, sugars, low salt. You need to start exercising regularly. You need to see your doctor at least once a year for your annual checkups, to do all the usual checkups that you should do, which are check your blood sugar, check your cholesterol, check your blood pressure. If you're a man, you need to start thinking about checking your prostate-specific antigen, your PSA for prostate cancer. If you're a woman, you start breast cancer screening begins at the age of 40, although some advocate that in our country we should start earlier. Cervical cancer screening starts, you know, usually from time you're about 20, you know, doing your pap smears.
When you're sexually active,
that's when it starts, pretty much when it should start. So for ladies, it usually starts earlier, and ladies are usually much more vigilant and much more conscious about their health than men. Men are generally more careless, which is why when I see my male patients, I like their wives to come with them if they're married, because the wife is usually going to be very good at making sure that he adheres to the advice that I give, and also clarifying the history, because some men are a little bit shy about coming forward with how bad they actually feel, and the wife is there to provide a little bit more useful information.
So thank you so much, doctor. I think we can wrap it up there. So for people that are having pre-existing health conditions, the goal is now is the best time to have a love relationship with your doctor.
Absolutely.
To always check up on you. Thank you. I think we should bring you back. We've learned a lot today.
Without COVID-19.
when the COVID-19 drama is over. But we need to bring you back, because for us it was quite instructive to do this show today, because of people that, I mean, the deaths, the figures are there, and we're seeing that everybody that is dying from this disease is dying because
primarily
most of them truly have maybe frail health already.
Correct.
Yeah. Yes. Thank you so much, Dr. Tosi
Majeko-Dumi.
All right, so you can watch a repeat broadcast on Mondays, Saturdays, and Sundays at 3 p.m. It's been a very insightful conversation, isn't it?
Absolutely, always.
Chubby chick. All right, so continue the conversation on all our social media platforms as we continue to hear what you are saying. Now, in case you missed today's quote, here it is again. A man too busy to take care of his health is like a mechanic too busy to take care of his tools. That's a Spanish proverb. Do you agree with that?
Absolutely.
Do. Thank you so much, Dr. Tosi.
All right,
enjoy the rest of your evening.
Stay safe.
Stay safe.
Bye.